Hello everyone, welcome to a new session on molecular biology. Here we discuss site-directed mutagenesis. The generation and characterization of mutants is an essential component of any study on structure-function relationships. Knowledge of the three-dimensional structure of a protein, RNA or DNA can provide clues to the way in which they function, but proof for the fact that the correct mechanism has been elucidated requires the analysis of mutants that have amino acid or nucleotide changes at key residues. Mutants are generated by treating the test organism with chemical or physical agents that modify DNA. This method of mutagenesis has been extremely successful, as witnessed by the growth of molecular biology and functional genomics, but suffers from a number of disadvantages. First, any gene in the organism can be mutated, and the frequency with which mutants can occur in the gene of interest can be very low. This means that selection strategies have to be developed. Second, even when mutants with the desired phenotype are isolated, there is no guarantee that the mutation has occurred in the gene of interest. Third, prior to the development of gene cloning and sequencing techniques, there was no way of knowing where in the gene the mutation had occurred and whether it arose by a single base change, an insertion of DNA or a deletion. As techniques in molecular biology have developed, so that the isolation and study of a single gene is possible, so mutagenesis has also been refined. Instead of crudely mutagenizing many cells or organisms and then analyzing many thousands or millions of offspring to isolate a desired mutant, it is now possible to change specifically any given base in a cloned DNA sequence. This technique is known as site-directed mutagenesis. It has become a basic tool of gene manipulation, for it simplifies DNA manipulations that in the past required a great deal of ingenuity and hard work. For example, the creation or elimination of cleavage sites for restriction endonucleases. The importance of site-directed mutagenesis goes beyond gene structure-function relationships, for the technique enables mutant proteins with novel properties of value to be created by protein engineering. Such mutant proteins may have only minor changes, but it is not uncommon for entire domains to be deleted or new domains added. SDM is used for investigating the structure and biological activity of DNA, RNA, and protein molecules, and for protein engineering. Site-directed mutagenesis. Site-directed mutagenesis, or SDM, is a molecular biology method that is used to make specific and intentional changes to the DNA sequence of a gene and any gene products. SDM is an in vitro method for creating a specific mutation in a known sequence and is typically performed using PCR-based methods. Primers designed with mutations can introduce small sequence changes, and primer extension or inverse PCR can be used to achieve longer mutant regions. Site-directed mutagenesis technique allows researchers to investigate the impact of sequence changes or screen a variety of mutants to determine the optimal sequence for addressing the question at hand. Site-directed mutagenesis studies can be extremely useful for elucidating the function of a gene or protein, or for creating variants of an enzyme with new and improved functions. There are many reasons to make specific DNA alterations, such as insertions, deletions, and substitutions, including study changes in protein activity that occur as a result of the DNA manipulation, select or screen for mutations at the DNA, RNA, or protein level that have desired property, introduce or remove restriction endonuclease sites or tags. basic mechanism. The basic procedure requires the synthesis of a short DNA primer. This synthetic primer contains the desired mutation and is complementary to the template DNA around the mutation site, so it can hybridize with the DNA having the gene of interest. The mutation may be a single base change, that is a point mutation, multiple base changes, deletion or insertion. The single strand primer is then extended using a DNA polymerase which copies the rest of the gene. The gene thus copied contains the mutated site and is then introduced into a host cell as a vector and cloned. Finally, mutants are selected by DNA sequencing to check that they contain the desired mutation. The original method using single primer extension was inefficient due to a low yield of mutants. This resulting mixture contains both the original unmutated template as well as the mutant strand, producing a mixed population of mutant and non-mutant progenies. Furthermore, the template used is methylated while the mutant strand is unmethylated, and the mutants may be counter-selected due to the presence of mismatch repair system that favors the methylated template DNA, resulting in fewer mutants. Many approaches have since been developed to improve the efficiency of mutagenesis. Approaches in site-directed mutagenesis. Single primer method. The first method of site-directed mutagenesis to be developed was the single primer method, developed by Gilliam et al. 1980, Soller and Smith 1983. As originally described, the method involves in vitro DNA synthesis with a chemically synthesized oligonucleotide, which is 7 to 20 nucleotides long, that carries a base mismatch with the complementary sequence as shown in the following figure. The method requires the DNA to be mutated to be available in single strand form, and cloning the gene in M13 based vectors makes this easy. However, DNA cloned in a plasmid and obtained in duplex form can also be converted to a partially single stranded molecule, which is also suitable. This was developed by Dalbady McFarland et al. In 1982. The synthetic oligonucleotide primes DNA synthesis and is itself incorporated into the resulting heteroduplex molecule. After the transformation of the host E. coli, this heteroduplex gives rise to homoduplexes whose sequences are either that of the original wild type DNA or that containing the mutated base. The frequency with which mutated clones arise compared with wild type clones may be low. In order to pick out mutants, the clones can be screened by nucleic acid hybridization with P32 labeled oligonucleotide as PRO. Under suitable conditions of stringency, that is temperature and cation concentration, a positive signal will be obtained only with mutant clones. This allows ready detection of the desired mutant. This method was described by Wallace et al. 1981, Treboni et al. 1983. It is prudent to check the sequence of the mutant directly by DNA sequencing in order to find that the procedure has not introduced other adventitious changes. This was a particular necessity with early versions of the technique which made use of E. coli DNA polymerase. The more recent use of the high fidelity DNA polymerases has minimized the problem of extraneous mutations as well as shortening the time for copying the second strand. Also, these polymerases do not strand displace the oligoma, a process which would eliminate the original mutant oligonucleotide. A variation of the procedure, as shown in the figure, involves oligonucleotides containing inserted or deleted sequences. As long as stable hybrids are formed with single-stranded wild-type DNA, priming of in vitro DNA synthesis can occur, ultimately giving rise to clones corresponding to the inserted or deleted sequence. There are many different methods of oligonucleotide directed mutagenesis, but most are minor variations on desired mutant plasmids. Methods which destroy the wild type template strand of DNA and thus favor replication of the mutant strand, and methods which simply allow the wild type and mutant strands of DNA an equal chance of replicating. The Dutt-Ung method is an example of the first approach, and the Mutt-S method is an example of the second approach. Cassette mutagenesis. Cassette mutagenesis replaces a section of DNA sequence with a DNA fragment containing the mutated sequence. The insert and target fragments can be generated either by restriction digestion, PCR amplification, or commercial synthesis of products like IDT ultramer oligonucleotides or IDT genes. The restriction digestion method is dependent on the presence of restriction sites on each side of the area that will be replaced. These restriction sites may be present in the original plasmid or may be inserted into its sequence. In this method, the original plasmid is cleaved on either side of the region of interest with two restriction enzymes. This method can be clearly seen in the figure as shown in the screen. The new cassette is then ligated into the linearized plasmid. The PCR amplification method does not require specific restriction sites, but does require synthetic oligonucleotides. Cassette mutagenesis has many advantages. It is a very efficient technique and provides an easy way to screen mutants by simply sequencing the resulting plasmids. It provides flexibility to perform many different mutagenesis events on the same vector once set up with flanking restriction sites. Multiple cassettes can also be inserted throughout the vector. This figure explains the method of cassette mutagenesis. The original plasmid is cleaved with restriction enzymes A and E on either side of the cassette to be removed. The restriction digest creates a linearized plasmid fragment and a cassette. The new cassette, indicated in the blue color, containing the desired changes, is then ligated into the linearized plasmid. PCR site-directed mutagenesis. The exponential amplification in PCR produces a fragment mutation in sufficient quantity to be separated from the original unmutated plasmid by gel electrophoresis, which may be then inserted in the original context using standard recombinant molecular biology techniques. This involves a single step of PCR, but still has the inherent problem of requiring a suitable restriction site near the mutation site unless a very long primer is used. Other variations therefore employ 3 or 4 oligonucleotides, 2 of which may be non-mutagenic oligonucleotides that cover 2 convenient restriction sites and generate a fragment that can be digested and ligated into a plasmid, whereas the mutagenic oligonucleotide may be complementary to a location within that fragment, well away from any convenient restriction site. These methods require multiple steps of PCR so that the final fragment to be ligated can contain the desired mutation. Whole plasmid mutagenesis. In this method, a pair of complementary mutagenic primers are used to amplify the entire plasmid in a thermofidelity non-strand displacing DNA polymerase such as PFU polymerase. The reaction generates a nicked circular DNA. The template DNA must be eliminated by enzymatic digestion with a restriction enzyme such as DPN1, which is specific for methylated DNA. All DNA produced from most Escherichia coli strains would be methylated. The template plasmid that is biosynthesized in E. coli will therefore be digested, while the mutated plasmid which is generated in vitro and is therefore unmethylated would be left undigested. Note that in these double-stranded plasmid mutagenesis methods, while the thermocycling reaction may be used, the DNA need not be exponentially amplified as in a PCR. In vivo site-directed mutagenesis methods, Delitto Perfetto is a genetic technique for in vivo site-directed mutagenesis in yeast. This technique was developed at the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, NIEHS, by Michael A. Resnick, Francisca Storisi, and L. Kevin Lewis. The method uses synthetic oligonucleotides in combination with the cellular process of homologous recombination. Consequently, it is well suited for genetic manipulation of yeast, which has highly efficient homologous recombination. The Delitto Perfetto approach has been used to produce single and multiple point mutations, gene truncations or insertions, and whole gene deletions, including essential genes. Overlap extension method. It requires 4 oligonucleotide primers and 3 separate amplification reactions. 2 complementary mutagenic primers induce the mutation into the desired sequence of DNA, and 2 flanking primers amplify the mutant fragment and facilitate cloning of the PCR fragment into a suitable vector. By this approach, a variety of mutations can be created, such as single base pair changes, deletions, and insertions. First, 2 separate PCR reactions are set up in parallel. One reaction has the sense mutant primer and an antisense flanking primer 3' to the mutation site. The other reaction contains the antisense mutant primer and the sense flanking primer 5' to the mutation site. The other reaction contains the antisense mutant primer and the sense flanking primer 5' to the mutation site. The 2 amplified fragments contain mutations at the 5' or 3' terminus respectively. In the second round of amplification, the 2 fragments from the first round of PCR are purified and then used as templates for amplification using only the flanking primers. After amplification, the mutation is contained within the target DNA segment, which is cloned into appropriate vectors for DNA sequencing and subsequent functional studies. Mega primer method. This method uses only a single mutagenic primer to create mutations in the target template. In the first round of amplification, the wild type template is amplified using either a sense or antisense mutagenic primer and an appropriate flanking primer. The amplified product is then used in a second round of PCR with wild type template and the other flanking primer to create a fragment of the same length as the original target DNA containing the desired mutation. The key to this method is that the amplified product from the first round of PCR is used as a primer in the second round of PCR. Compared to the 4 primer method, this procedure requires only a single mutagenic primer and yields more of the full length product. This is probably due to the instability of the 10 to 20 base pair overlap between the 2 mutant templates during the second round of amplification when using the 4 primer method. In the mega primer method, the overlap between the template and the mutagenic strands is more extensive. Comparison of PCR in site-directed mutagenesis methods. Technique 1, traditional PCR with modified primers. This type of site-directed mutagenesis uses PCR primers designed to contain the desired change. The PCR primer sequence simply replaces the original sequence as long as the changes are minimal enough to allow the primer to anneal to the intended target. When PCR is used for site-directed mutagenesis, the primers are designed to include the desired change, which could be base substitution, addition, or deletion. During PCR, the mutation is incorporated into the amplicon, replacing the original sequence. Mutations introduced by PCR can only be incorporated into regions of sequence complementary to the primers and not regions between the primers. This technique can be used for limited base identity changes at the end of the target sequence and also for 5' or 3' terminal insertions, which are less than 100 bases. Technique 2, primer extension PCR. Site-directed mutagenesis by primer extension involves incorporating mutagenic primers in independent nested PCRs before combining them in the final product. The reaction requires flanking primers such as A and D complementary to the ends of the target sequence and two internal primers with complementary ends such as B and C. These internal primers contain the desired mutation and will hybridize to the region to be altered. During the first round of PCR, the AB and CD fragments are created. These products are mixed for the second round of PCR using primers A and D. The complementary ends of the products hybridize in the second PCR to create the final product AD, which contains the mutated internal sequence. Longer insertions can be incorporated by using specially long primers such as oligonucleotides. To create a deletion, the internal primers B and C are positioned at either side of the region to be deleted to prevent it from being incorporated within fragments A, B and C, D from the first round of PCR. The complementary sequences at the ends of these fragments created by primers B and C enable hybridization of AB to CD during the second round of PCR and the final product with the desired deletion AD is created. This technique can be used for limited non-random base changes internal to the target sequence and also for insertions which are greater than 100 bases, deletions which are less than 50 bases and deletions which are also greater than 50 bases. Technique 3, inverse PCR. Inverse PCR enables amplification of a region of unknown sequence using primers oriented in the reverse direction. An adaptation of this method can be used to introduce mutations in previously cloned sequences. Using primers incorporating the desired change, an entire circular plasmid is amplified to delete, change or insert the desired sequence. This technique can be used for insertions which are greater than 100 bases, deletions which are less than 50 bases and deletions which are also greater than 50 bases. Disadvantages of PCR based in vitro mutagenesis methods. The major disadvantage of PCR based in vitro mutagenesis methods is the lower fidelity of TAC DNA polymerase in DNA polymerization than the phage polymerases used in the traditional methods. This can result in undesired mutations being incorporated into the amplified DNA fragment due to nucleotide misincorporation. If this happens in an early round of amplification, the undesired mutation will be present in a majority of cloned fragments. One simple way to alleviate this problem is to use fewer rounds of DNA amplification and conditions for the highest fidelity of DNA polymerization. Alternatively, the use of PFU or vent thermal stable polymerases, which are less error prone than TAC polymerase, will result in fewer undesired mutations. Regardless of which method is used, the DNA sequence of the entire amplified fragment should be determined to ensure that only the desired changes have been made. Applications. Site-directed mutagenesis is used to generate mutations designed protein that has improved or special properties. For example, as seen in protein engineering. Investigative tools. Specific mutations in DNA allow the function and properties of a DNA sequence to be investigated in a rational approach. Commercial applications. Proteins may be engineered to produce mutant forms that are tailored for a specific application. For example, commonly used laundry detergents may contain subtilisin, whose wild type form has a methionine that can be oxidized by bleach, significantly reducing the activity of the protein in the process. This methionine may be replaced by alanine or other residues, making it resistant to oxidation, thereby keeping the protein active in the presence of bleach. Eliminate any foreign DNA from the genome after the mutagenesis process. The Delitto Perfetto technique is also simpler compared to other methods for in vivo side-directed mutagenesis. There is great flexibility in this approach because after the core cassette is inserted, multiple mutations in the gene of interest can be made easily and quickly. This method can be applied to other organisms where homologous recombination is efficient, such as the MOS Fiscomitrella patens, DT40 chicken cells, or E. coli. In addition, human genes can be studied and similarly genetically manipulated in yeast by using yeast artificial chromosomes or YACs. A particularly powerful method for protein evolution, termed DNA shuffling, uses the polymerase chain reaction to generate proteins with novel or improved properties. Here are a few questions for you to work out. 1. Explain about the evolution of side-directed mutagenesis applications. 2. Discuss on DNA shuffling. 3. Elaborate the Dutt-Ung method. 4. Discuss on Mutt-S method. 5. Describe in vivo side-directed mutagenesis methods. Here I can suggest a few research papers for your reference. New Molecular Biology Methods for Protein Engineering by Soller M.J. 1991, published in Current Opinions Biotechnology. Polymerase Chain Reaction PCR Techniques for Side-Directed Mutagenesis by Rifovsky J. and Tau B.Y., published in the year 1992 in Biotechnology Advances. Side-Directed Mutagenesis by Overlap Extension Using the Polymerase Chain Reaction by Ho S. N., Hunt H. D., Horton R. M. et al., 1989, in The Gene. Genetic Applications of an Inverse Polymerase Chain Reaction, written by Ochman H., Gerber A. S. and Hartle D. L., published in Genetics, 1988. Side-directed mutagenesis in one day with greater than 80% efficiency, written by Papworth C., Boyer J. C., Brahman J. and Wright D. A., published in Strategies in the year 1996. Simple and efficient side-directed mutagenesis using two single primer reactions in parallel to generate mutants for protein structure function studies, written by Edelhit O., Hanikoglu A., Hanikoglu I., published in BMC Biotechnology in the year 2009. Thank you for watching this program. Let's meet in the next session. Till then, bye.